Tonight, we are very delighted to have with us Ms. Julie Barton and Dog Medicine, How My Dog Saved Me From Myself. Dog Medicine captures the anguish of depression, the slow path to recovery, the beauty of forgiveness, and the astonishing ways animals can help heal even the most broken hearts and minds. Dog Medicine is as raw and unflinching as it is heartwarming. It follows Julie through her difficult relationship with her brother, unhealthy romantic relationships, and the depression that has always just simmered below the surface. Julie Barton holds a BA from Kenyon College, MFA in writing from Vermont College of Fine Arts, and women's studies from Southern Connecticut State University. She lives in North California with her husband, two daughters, and a small menagerie of pets. Please give her a nice warm welcome, Ms. Julie Barton.
Hi, can you hear me? Is that working? Hi, Internet. So crazy. Hi. Thank you, Books and Books, for having me, and thank you to all of you for coming. I really appreciate it. So what I usually like to do at these readings is tell you a little bit about the book, since it's pretty new, and then I'll read a little bit from it, and we can watch a video of the beautiful dog while I'm reading. There will be puppy videos. It's always good, right? And then we'll do. Didn't bring tissues. Okay, well, you gotta use your shirt. And then we'll have a little conversation and some questions. Okay. So, you know, I'm traveling around the country right now. I'm on my third week of this incredible tour that I'm so grateful to be doing, and I'm doing it. I'm going to all these audiences and saying that I'm here to talk to you about the love of my life, who was very handsome. He was a dark redhead. He was very friendly. He's very smart. He did drink out of the toilet now and then. And he was my golden retriever, Bunker Hill, who found me when I was at my lowest, which was when I was 22 years old, and I'd graduated from college, and I decided after college, I grew up in Ohio, and I thought I didn't want to be in Ohio, and I wanted to be a big city girl, so I left Ohio, and I moved to New York, and I got a job in publishing, and I had a boyfriend, and things were going okay, and then they started to not go okay. I lost my boyfriend, my job was pretty boring, and what was simmering underneath the surface for me very intensely was a constant stream of self-loathing, really negative thoughts that I thought about myself. You know, you're stupid, you're ugly, nobody likes you. And I didn't know that, I didn't notice that I was doing this until one day I came home from work and I'd been having a really hard time. I was having a lot of suicidal thoughts, not really knowing what they were or why or how I should be dealing with this, or that there was really anything wrong. It was 1996, and you know, depression or mental illness wasn't really in the public lexicon yet. So I got home from work that day, and I went to put a pot of water to boil on the stove, and all I could think was, I can't do this. I give up. And I lied down on my kitchen floor, and I guess I fell asleep. I don't know. I woke up and my whole apartment was filled with smoke because the water had boiled down and evaporated and the pot was crackling. And I don't know how long I was out. And I was aware vaguely that I was out. And then I noticed vaguely that I was crying, that I was sobbing. And I thought something happened. So over the course of about 36 hours, I crawled across my apartment floor, got to the phone, and I called my mom, and I said, "Mom, I think I had a breakdown." And she said, "Stay where you are. I'm getting in the car. I'll be there in 9 hours." She drove from Central Ohio to New York and picked me up and took me home, and, you know, that saved me, but I also felt like I was a failure. I had failed at this new life in the city. I had failed at life as a young woman, you know, who was going to take the city by storm and be this up-and-coming writer, and I got home and I sank further, and my parents tried to help. My dad took me fishing. My mom and dad got me to a psychiatrist. They got me to a therapist. And I was gone. You know, there's a lot of ways that we deal with stress and trauma. And my way at this point was emptiness. But the only thing I thought might help me was adopting a dog. Because when I was a kid, when things were not going well, when I didn't feel safe in my home, I would go outside and take the dog, or I'd go to my room and take the dog. And the dog didn't have an opinion. The dog didn't judge me. The dog made me laugh and made me feel like I was loved by something. And so I said to my mom, I think I want to adopt a dog. And she said, okay. And so within the next few days, because my mom does not waste time, we found two litters in the newspaper, because it was pre-internet. And we went and looked at one, and I didn't find any that I liked. And then we went and looked at the next litter, and I was standing outside this white farmhouse in rural Ohio, and this little dog walked up to me, sat right against my feet, and looked up at me. And it was like, he was like, I choose you. And I said, okay. And I picked him up, and he licked my nose. And that was it. I took him home. He fell sound asleep in my lap. And for the first time in a really long time, I felt tethered back to this earth. I felt like there's something here holding me. And the next morning I woke up, and it was the first morning of my life that I woke up and I didn't feel dread. And I didn't know that this dread was gone until it was gone. I didn't know that it was there until it was gone. I'd never noticed that I woke up thinking I don't want this day until I woke up one day and I didn't feel that way. It was a miracle. And I thought, if I can wake up like this once, maybe I can wake up like this again. And, you know, first I thought, those first few days with him, I thought, well, maybe this is just because puppy isn't cute and distracting. And, you know, within about 2 weeks, I started to sink again. And I thought, just getting a puppy can't, you know, help me. I'm beyond help. And I started to cry, and I sat on my couch in my parents' house, and the dog was sitting across the room, and he noticed, and he walked over to me, and he sat on my feet, and he leaned against my shins, and he looked up at me as if to say, does that help? Or maybe it was, I see you. I don't know what it was, but he noticed, and just the noticing was so healing. And I think part of the reason that it's so healing when a dog notices and when an animal does is because they don't want you to explain. They don't care why. They just want to be with you. They don't want you to, they don't come up to you and say, stop crying, or what's wrong, and tell me what's wrong. Because I didn't have language then for what was happening for me. And the presence of this dog being there with me and comforting me ended up giving me the language. And he did this for me his whole life. And he saved my life. There were days where when I woke up and I thought, I don't feel okay, but I have him, so I'll be okay. So I'm gonna read to you a little bit from the book, from right around the time that he did his first kind of, you know, medicine lean on me. So we can get the video started. So this is, I've had him for a little while, and I have decided that I'm going to train him because I want to be a responsible dog owner. So this is me trying to train my puppy. That's his Elmo doll. All right, so this chapter is called First Lesson. Bunker had a lot to learn. He was mellow for a puppy, but he tugged on the leash, chewed everything in sight, and didn't exactly come when called. The dog training book said that dogs who know they're not in charge are relaxed and happy, and their work is only to follow and obey. A dog that is led to believe he's the alpha dog will act out and can become anxious and even aggressive because he's under the illusion that taking care of the pack is his responsibility. I wanted Bunker to know that he was safe and I was the boss, so I took him outside for some training that would help him see me as his pack leader. Out in the yard, with a 15-foot leash, I followed the book's instructions to walk quietly in a square as big as the yard would allow. I was to hold the leash with two hands at my chest, pay no attention to Bunker, stop at the corners, and just walk in one big cornered loop. I would use no voice commands and never yank on the leash, just keep walking. And if he fell, I would slow down so he could right himself. But otherwise, I was just to walk. The idea was that he would learn slowly to stay by my side. I was the alpha, and I felt enormously capable of being in charge and taking care of this precious dog. When I began walking, Bunker was like a housefly on the end of a fishing line, darting in every direction. Instructions for the lesson included avoiding eye contact, but watching peripherally. He spotted a squirrel and raced into the woods after it, then hit the end of the leash, his back feet flipping under his soft puppy body. A bird hopped through beds of leaves at the edge of the woods, and Bunker lunged toward it, tripped, and got dragged a few feet. I slowed to let him catch up, but didn't acknowledge him. I paused, could feel that he'd righted himself and had begun to walk again, so I sped up. Sometimes he disappeared from my line of sight completely, and I had to trust that he was walking and okay until I felt a pull on the leash. My mom thought the sight of me dragging my puppy around the yard was funny, so she grabbed the video camera and hid behind a bush, laughing and filming. And Bunker caught her scent, and he pulled toward her as I walked in the opposite direction. And this resulted in another wipeout and a 3-foot dragging through the grass. If my mom thought I'd finally truly lost my mind, she knew not to say so. She just laughed as I walked, stopped, turned, walked, stopped, turned, and this poor little puppy tried to keep up. I laughed too at first, but after several rotations, the slow walk became like a meditation, and with each turn, I began to realize that Bunker and I were becoming a pack of two. He was learning to trust and follow me, and I was learning that I could lead confidently. And when I felt him dragging at the end of the lead, I was terrified I might hurt him, but I began to understand the lesson we were learning. If we were attentive to each other, we would both be okay. Within about 10 minutes, Bunker understood. He trotted at my side, looking up at me to see which way my eyes were turned. He'd figured out that I looked in the direction I was going to go next, and his puppy paws lumbered to keep up with me, but he stayed by my side. He wasn't tugging at all now, not getting distracted. I could feel that he was happy to follow me, relieved even. When we came inside, he collapsed on the floor with fatigue. I carried him to my room and put him in his crate, and I lay on the bed next to him and felt myself drifting off as well. As he fell asleep, he opened his eyes at the slightest noise to make sure I was still close by. "Don't worry, buddy," I said. "I'm right here. I'll always be right here." And at that, we both fell into a deep sleep. Wasn't he adorable? You know, when I wrote that scene, I didn't have that video. I knew that my mom had taken that video, but I didn't know where it was. And then, like, I don't know, maybe 5 years ago, she put all of our old VHSs on CDs and or on DVDs, and she sent it to me. And I watched it after I'd written it, and I was like, I kind of got it right. And it was true that after all, you know, enough rotations, it was like we were just aligning ourselves with each other. And he was that way his whole life. He didn't need a leash. He was pretty remarkable. So I'm not going to tell you too much about what happens after that, but I'm in Ohio, and I don't want to stay in Ohio. I feel like I need to go someplace else, someplace challenging, someplace different. And I get a phone call, a very fortuitous phone call from an old friend from high school, and she says, "I'm in Seattle, and I'm moving into a house with these two guys, and we're going to get a dog." And I was like, "Is this a joke?" And then she said, "Why don't you come?" And so after some long nights and decision-making and writing lists of pros and cons, I decided to go. And when I got there, things were going great, really well, until they weren't. And They weren't because something was wrong with Bunker. And at 8 months old, I took him to the veterinarian, and when they took a look at his case, they said, you need to put him down. And I knew that I was recovering. I wasn't well yet. I was getting well, but the depression was and still is, you know, it's not something that you cure, especially like severe clinical depression. It's something that you work with your whole life and you take care of, and you learn to be very self-aware and take really good care of yourself. And I got better. But when I got that news that my dog's life was in jeopardy, I knew that if he didn't make it, I wasn't going to make it. I'd had him for less than a year. And so I'm not going to tell you what happens, because I know some of you haven't read it, but I wasn't defeated. I didn't lie on the couch and cry. I thought, he saved me, and now I have to save him. And he lived to be 11 years old. He died in 2007, and I have been writing fiction for much of my young life. And the day after he died, I found out that I was a finalist in a prestigious writing contest, and I hadn't been writing very much up until then. And when I got that news, I thought, this is a directive from Bunker to tell our story. And then I thought, well, I can't tell that story. I can't tell the world that I was so incredibly dependent on my dog that if something were to happen to him, I would have taken my own life. And I thought, well, I can write it and nobody has to see it. But the more I wrote it and the more I told my truth on the page, the more I was wildly vulnerable both with myself and with my readers, the more I thought, I have to do this. And so I put it out in the world initially with a tiny little press, a beautiful press out of Minnesota called Think Peace, which is a mental health imprint. And within the first few days, the book was sold out everywhere online. And I called my mom and I said, Mom, did you buy all the books? And she said, I promise I didn't. And I realized that I'd struck a nerve, and I told a story that other people had felt. And it has been an incredible privilege to meet all these people that I've met who have a similar story, whether it's with their dog or their cat, their horse. I even met a guy whose daughter had a therapy rat, which was cool. I was like, is it trained? Is it a trained rat? And he's like, no. She just likes the comfort of this touch of this animal brings her back down and helps her feel okay. I was like, I get it. I know that. So what I learned is that not only am I not alone, there's a lot of us out there. I get emails every day from people saying thank you. And this is my forever dog. This is my medicine dog. And they send me pictures. I love it. And so after it was out with a small press for a couple months, I got a phone call saying Penguin Books would like to publish your book. And I'll never forget that. It was a wonderful day. And now, I mean, the beauty of it is that I get to reach more people. I wouldn't be here without them. I wouldn't be in this store without them and without, you know, the reach that they have. And I'm just sort of on a mission to tell stories of healing, how, you know, the sorrow can come and take us. And healing comes in many forms. And it's our job to open ourselves up to it when it arrives. Mine happened to be four-legged and shed like crazy and walk pretty funny most of his life. But there's no question in my mind that he saved me. And so this is my homage to him. I'm on the road to talk about my love. My husband is very well aware that I have a soulmate that is a dog and not him, and that the love of my life is a dog. He's okay with it. He knew that going in. But, you know, it's an important topic. 15 million Americans suffer from depression. And in young people age 15 to 24, suicide is the second leading cause of death behind car accidents. There's so much sorrow and we need to just be talking about it. It's okay to talk about it. And when you connect, I mean, that was the other thing. When I had Bunker and I would go out on the street with him, people would talk to me and say, oh, he's so cute. What's his name? How old is he? And that helped bridge this connection. And connection breeds happiness. Disconnection breeds sorrow. So I'm going on the road to share that with everybody. And I'm just really grateful that you're all here and that you know, we can share a little Bunker love. So with that, should we have some questions? Would you like to have a little conversation? I think Steve's got a microphone. He'll pass to whoever. Okay, we'll do with that. I will repeat the question for the internet folks. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. That's a good question. So the question is, why did I choose to end the book where I did instead of, because I skipped about, I guess it's like 10 years that I skipped. A lot of it is because for his whole life, I dreaded the day I was going to lose him. And a lot of people ask me, you were so depressed when you got him and he helped you. What happened to you after he died? And I wanted to answer that question for the reader. and the way that, so he died and within, I think it was 2 years later, I had his ashes, and I don't want to give away too much, but I wanted to feel connected to him. You know, when you lose somebody, some people say, like, I had a dream, and they showed up in my dream, and I had no dreams of him. I had, you know, no magical things happening, and I was like, where are you? You know, I missed him, and I needed to feel him. And so I went to the ocean, and I took his ashes, and I wanted to feel him, and lo and behold, he showed up for me. And so I thought that that would be a good place to end it, to show people that, you know, even years later, the connection is that strong, and I know he's with me. And so I, that was such a beautiful moment that I thought it would be a good spot to end it. But I also, you know, on my website, there's a video of the day I wrote that scene. I did like a writing retreat at a hotel where I just went to a hotel by myself, because otherwise my children and husband interrupt me. So I would go to these hotel retreats and I'd write for 24, 48 hours. And one of those was, I thought, well, I need to write an epilogue. And I think I wanted to write that scene. And I wrote that scene. I cried through the whole writing of it, but it all came together in a really beautiful way that I wasn't anticipating. And that's sort of the beauty of art and literature. And, you know, you can put these experiences in a frame that shows you how it all is connected. And it's really beautiful. And even when we lose something beloved, there's still a lot of hope and a lot of joy. And so that was partly why I ended it there. And also the years in between were kind of boring. Got married, I moved, you know, the first few years of marriage and, you know, all the trials and tribulations that come with that. A lot of people are asking me what I'm going to write next. And one of the thoughts I had was maybe I will write those next 10 years, but then just put it in a vault and let my kids open it when they're 35. 'Cause I really don't know if the whole world needs to know about that. Any more questions? Yeah. Did you get another dog? I did. I got another dog. He's a rescue. We're his fourth home. He looks like Toto with huge, enormous ears. And every time I cry or I'm sad, he runs to the other end of the house and hides. I'm like, what is going on here? But I do think that he has something to teach me about trusting after you've been betrayed. He is most definitely my shadow now, and my daughter's too. And I think he's really grateful for consistent love and attention. He's almost 10 years old now. So very different, but still pretty wonderful. Yeah. Oh, interesting. Okay, so the first part was, do I believe that animals have souls? The second part is, what did I keep and what did I give up when I moved the book to Penguin? The first part, absolutely, no question. My dog had a soul. And I know that it starts to get so complicated, like, what is a soul? I don't know, but there's an essence of him that I still feel. And that when he and I met, it was like magnets. You know, it was like we were seeing each other either again or for the first time. I don't know. But I do believe they do. I believe they have souls and consciousnesses, and I believe it's important that we treat them with love and respect and watch and learn from them. There's something beautiful about these creatures that we share this earth with, that they don't have language. And yeah, there they go. They do. They have their own language, but they don't have words. And so we can watch them and learn. I mean, clearly we've learned. What did I give up when I switched to Penguin? They didn't change a single word. They didn't change anything. I just shortened the acknowledgments. I had them keep the cover because this was the cover that I was insistent upon. This is Bunker when he was about 3. And one of the questions the first publisher had was, should we Photoshop out the drool? I said, no. Absolutely. No. So Penguin was, they took it as it was, and they've been incredible, and they didn't change a word. Did I keep the rights? Well, when you publish with anybody, you sign over the rights for a little while anyway. And it's being published in 6 countries. So, you know, it's been translated into Dutch. Next is French and Italian, and it's in the UK now. You know, I don't know about Spanish. Any Spanish publishers watching online? Hi. but, you know, I don't know. There must be something universal about it. Thank you. Yeah. Yes.
Bunker. And other dogs, because I have 2 dogs, and I relate 110%.
Mm-hmm.
The first thing I think of in the morning is their, welfare. Every day, during the day when I'm gone, is their welfare. At night when they're gone, there's cameras everywhere, so I'm watching a lot of that to make sure, because they're the medicine that keeps us alive. Well, speaking for myself.
Yeah. Yeah. So the question is, how am I going to pay it forward and spread the word about what dogs do for us? And you shared how you feel when you're not with your dogs, which is exactly how I felt when I wasn't with my Bunker. I was like, how is he? Is he okay? Did I lock the door? You know, and we didn't have cameras back then. at this point, what I'm doing is this. I'm out spreading the word about this and sharing this story, because, you know, when I first had the idea to write this book, I told a few people and they laughed, not in a mean way, but in a, wow, that's so cute kind of way. And it's not actually cute. It's not, you know, Old Yeller and Lassie. This is my lifeline. This is why I got up in the morning for 11 years. And so right now, this is what I'm doing to spread that word, because I think that it's maybe not quite understood how real it is for many people. And I think that might be where a lot of the readers who contact me that are so grateful say, yeah, you know, my mom just says, why are you always so worried about the dog? And why do you always have to go home to feed the dog? I mean, I hear that from people. And, you know, it's more than just being concerned or anxious. It's a really real connection that is so beautiful. I mean, thank goodness we have them, right? And so this is a celebration of that. And it's a love letter to Bunker. And it's also a love letter to my family and to my husband. You know, I didn't talk about it much in the initial part, but one of the, you know, traumas of my life was a really, really difficult relationship with my brother. I had a really difficult sibling relationship, and it was emotionally and physically very trying. And I think that was one of the sources of my negative thinking and really rough sort of self-worth issues. And, you know, talking about that has been really rewarding as well, because a lot of people say, you know, so many people talk about, you know, parents abusing kids and uncles and aunt, you know, but people don't talk about kids hurting each other. You know, when a kid is hurting and hurting another kid, I was one of those. And so, you know, there's a lot of different sort of truths that, you know, when you write a book like this and it's your heart and you open it up to the whole world to see, first of all, that takes a lot of confidence. And I've never been a particularly confident person until I had this story, because, you know, when you write memoir and you write what is true, there's nothing that can push you down. Bad reviews, whatever, there's nothing that can make you feel like this is not the truest thing you've ever known. The truest thing I've ever known is that my dog saved my life. And so I'm on, you know, a mission to spread that story, and it seems to be resonating happily. Yeah. Mm-hmm. What do you think? Yeah. So the question is, how did I approach my family and tell them I was going to do this? it took a long time to write, and so they all kind of knew that I was in my office noodling away on something. And when it came time to that, I had this small press that was interested in it. I sent it to my parents, and I sent it to my brother, and I showed it to my husband, and I showed it to my best friend, and her husband was there in it. And the ones I was most worried about was my brother and my parents. And my parents read it on the plane when they were flying from Ohio to California to see me. They read it for the first time on the plane. They get off the plane, they're in like baggage claim, and they're like, we, you know, their faces, they've been crying, and I'm thinking, oh no, like, they're so devastated, and what I'm, you know, I'm already ready to apologize, and my dad looks at me and he says, Julie, this is going to be a New York Times bestseller. And I was like, that was not what I was expecting it here, and also not possible with, you know, the small press that I was with at that point. And, you know, obviously still a long shot, but my parents not only approved, but they were so proud of me for the way I'd written it and for the honesty. Initially, my brother, I sent it to him in the same way in an email, and he didn't reply. So a few months later, I said, you know, did you read it? And he said, you have my blessing and you can publish it, but I don't want to read about what a jerk I was as a kid. And I thought, uh-oh, like I can't go forward with that. And so then I sort of just was quiet for a while and sat there, and maybe I sat in the galleys because it was getting closer, and about 2 months, 3 months before it was born, out of the blue, he posted on Instagram a picture of me with Bunker's ashes that I'd posted. He reposted it and said, "I just finished my sister's book, and it's really, really, really good. I'm so proud of her, except she made me cry in the airport." And I'll never forget that moment. It was so beautiful. It was, and we had a long conversation. We've had a lot of long healing conversations where, you know, he said, maybe we can help some people. I mean, there's many ways to make amends for things. And this is, I think, one of his. But I also do really like to point out, and, you know, when I talk about this sibling violence that we endured, he was a child when this was happening. And it wasn't like he was, you know, he was bigger than me and he was older than me, but he was still a child and he was hurting. And so it's not like he was born a bad person. You know, there's, you know, I forgive him and we forgive each other. But for him to give the book his blessing was really great. And then my husband, everybody changed their names in the book. I asked everybody, what do you want your name to be? Some of the names people came back with, I'm like, really? Okay. And I had to read the audiobook, and my aunt chose Aunt Aurora as her name. It's like the hardest name for me to say. I'm like, Aurora. It was very hard to say. But my husband said, I don't want you to change my name. His name is Greg. He said, I don't want you to change my name because I'm proud of how I acted. And I said, awesome. That's great. So his name is Greg. And Bunker's name is Bunker. And my name is Julie. But everything else is different. Yeah, I sent it to all the exes. Well, there's only two, so I sent it to them, and I think it was probably hard for them to read. One of them posted on Amazon and said it was great, and he loved it and gave it a great review. So, you know, I think it's hard to, you know, I pity anybody who's in a memoirist life, because you will get written about. But if you're a good memoirist, you write about every aspect of that person. And even the part where you know, if I was hurt by somebody, there may be something that this person is experiencing that is why they hurt me. And I have to think about them in a 360 way. I have to think about all of the different aspects of their life and what they were going through. And so I tried to do that with everybody in the book. And they've all been really supportive, pretty lucky. Any more questions? Okay, one more. No. Well, I started writing it after he passed away, but the book actually begins. I started writing it after he died. Yes, and it, yeah. Yeah. So the question is, how long between after he passed and when I started writing the book did it come out in the world? Well, when he died, I was 7 months pregnant with my second child, and so I wrote very, very part time for quite a while. He died in 2007. The book first came out in 2015. I finished it in 2014. So I'd say 7 years, but very part time for much of that. You know, the idea for the book came the day after he died, and it felt like it was like one of those zing messages from beyond, write our story. So I did. Yes. That's okay. he was 10 weeks old, I think, when I got him. So in that video, he was probably, I'd say, 3.5 or 4 months. He died of cancer, and he was diagnosed. I took him in because, do you remember when there was that pet food scare, where there was, like, food from China that was killing dogs? he had been sleeping in my daughter's room because she'd been having bad dreams. He never didn't sleep next to me, but my two-year-old was having bad dreams, and so he started sleeping in her room. And one morning I went in, there was a spot of blood on the carpet. And so I took my daughter to preschool that day. I took him into the vet, and they did an x-ray of his abdomen, and they caught the corner of his lung. And they said, and then they took his whole lungs, and it was riddled with cancer, and they gave him 4 to 6 weeks to live, and he lived 10 days. And one of the more beautiful stories of his passing is that my two-year-old at the time, after he died, she came home from preschool, and we told her, and the first thing she said was, "But mommy, who will protect me from the monsters?" And I had the same thought. I didn't know who was going to protect me from the monsters, but I was a parent now. And I said to her, "Daddy and I are here for you, and we're going to be here for you your whole life." And, you know, it was one of those moments where, you know, you can't articulate to a two-year-old, this dog is going to help you and protect you. But she felt it too. And so I knew it was something special. But yeah, he died way too quickly. He was 11. But he's still with me, I know. He's right here. Thank you all so much for having me and for coming.
That was great. Folks, I know you're still watching online because I just checked out there and there's quite a few of you. So please give us a call and we'll get a book signed for you. For all of you here, the books are for sale behind the counter. Buy a couple of copies. We'll get them signed for you. I'm going to move this table over here when I clear off the AV. That was a great, wonderful, moving presentation. We really appreciate it. Can we get another round of applause for our author, please? That was great. Thank you all so much, and thank you all for coming. Thank you for watching.